The 2nd of October, it's Channel 4, and this is the 11 o'clock show. I'm Fred MacAulay.
I'm Brendon Burns.
Je m'appelle Iain Lee.
Iain Lee, need to keep you Eurodress viewers with us for the next half hour, baiting political satire.
You know, I'm starting to like Iain in a special way.
Brendon, there's no time for your saucy antipodean wit this evening. We're in a hurry. Here's today's news in 60 seconds. FTSE down hundreds as Nikkei Index marks up Dow Jones percentage annuity. If anyone actually knows what this means, you're now much poorer than you were this morning. Blair furious at being upstaged by Prescott's hilarious speech.
Hague the vague as we know him in Parliament.
The next time he tries this, he is immediately hit and punished for it.
In London, the auction is announced of a piece of paper on which John Lennon wrote the F-word 104 times. It's his review of Mullop Kintyre. As Walkers sign up Michael Owen and Cheese No and Crisps join Salt and Lineker on the shelves, David Seaman says he's still hopeful of a contract to promote the new extremely salted flavour. Coming up the show, Ali G, the Channel 4 voice of youth, gets to grips with Judge Pickles.
In my view, dealing a bit, what, smoking a bit, breaking a bit, stabbing a bit, whatever, is fair.
Stabbing a bit, did you say?
Well, yeah.
Dominic Jolly unnerved some of Tony's cronies in Blackpool.
But what happens if next year they just say to you, no, we're not having any people with beards and not ties?
Well, it's rather problematic, well, they'll be here next year anyway.
Right, because they won't let you in.
That jammy wee bastard that's married to Nicole Kidman, or as you may know him, Tom Cruise, turned real-life hero today when he chased off two jewel thieves.
The tiny star compared here with a normal Hollywood actor set off in hot pursuit of the dangerous thugs after they attacked a woman in a London street.
Without a thought for his own safety, Titchy Tom leapt her defence, accompanied by only two minders.
What must the muggers have thought? Christ, here comes Tom Cruise. He's rock. He can shake a cocktail.
Or was it, shit, there's two big bouncers after us and they've got a child with them.
This isn't the first time that plucky Tom has saved the day. 2 years ago, he saved a family from a burning yacht after he had taken control of the situation.
That's right. Tom doesn't just lend a helping hand, he
takes control.
We couldn't clear the proper music, so we got the soundtrack from Morph.
2 years ago, courageous Cruise saved a child from a cinema queue crush.
Did he take control?
Yes, he took control. With no thought for himself and with no bouncers at all, he single-handedly unhooked the red rope and let the child out.
Thanks, Tom. Where would we be without you?
And your minders.
And your publicists.
And your wife taking a kid off 5 nights a week.
Weird science, cutting off bits of one person and sticking them to another. Ugh. This week, an Australian had the hand of a French man grafted onto his wrist in a Paris surgery. Kind of a second-hand thing. Earlier today, I went and stood on the street to explain it to you again. Here I am on this TV, here on Film Earlier Now. Look. This week, science has gone bonkers. There's a story of the man who had the hand transplant, the story of the third-hand heart, and now, according to the Daily Mirror, we'll all be able to have face-swap operations within 5 years. But are people ready for this load of mentalist progress? I'm here to ask them. Whose hand would you go for if you had the option?
Probably one of the supermodel's husbands, I'd say.
Why is that?
Well, it's sort of been on a supermodel.
So then you could then use that hand that had been on a supermodel, you could then use on yourself. So Jeremy Beadle's hand, Paul Daniels' hand, something like that?
Jeremy Beadle's hand.
Yeah. Why is that?
It's a very tricky man.
Yeah. What celebrity's face would you like to wear? Just above here.
Des O'Connor.
Is there anyone's face in particular that you'd say, no, I don't want that on my shoulders?
Probably David Miller.
If you had a choice, there's only two faces left between Dean Gaffney from EastEnders and Simon Weston. Whose face would you take?
I'd go without.
I do not want to face a Frank Black from Andy Peters.
Yeah, this is what I look like as Bob Carroll, geez. It's not right.
I don't want to face transplant from Richard Madeley.
Face swapping is one thing, but is there anything people wouldn't swallow? The Chinese are talking about grafting Princess Diana's head on the body of a horse.
That would be pretty shameful, actually.
Why would it be shameful?
She was a very beautiful lady, and
it's a very beautiful horse. Who would you feel more substitute for, the horse or the lady?
I don't know. I think it's just quite sick in a way.
She had a nice body, and that's a horse.
Great fetlocks, I don't think. Yeah.
This is wrong. This is what I look like with a rabbit's head. Genetic engineering is wrong.
This is what I look like with a frog's head, and genetic engineering is really wrong.
In the week that science went mad, this has been Iain Lee for the 11 o'clock show.
Now, we're particularly upset today to hear that cable channel Live TV has sacked its news bunny. If you've never seen Live TV, and let's face it, 59.5 million of you won't, the news bunny is a rabbit who reads the news.
Sex gets better with age. A new poll reveals that women between 45 and 59 years of age are the happiest with their sex lives.
Incidentally, that is news bunny upset. You didn't realise what you're missing, did you? But you won't be seeing this rodent news analysis anymore, because in an effort to move up market, Live TV has replaced the bunny with a woman who reads the news while playing the cello.
Switzerland's about to introduce a heavy vehicle road tax.
Great, wasn't she? What is it about women playing the cello that is so sexy?
Well, I can tell you, Fred, it's the rich, alluring gleam of the mahogany, the round, sensuous curves, the haunting, tremulous tones as the bow slides smoothly across the strings. That and the fact that you know she can really get her legs wide open. Ain't that right, Marley?
In your dreams.
Since getting the boot from TV, we've discovered that things haven't been easy for the news bunny.
Bright eyes, burning like fire. Bright eyes, having a closing prayer. How can the light that burns so brightly suddenly burn so
now, as you see, there aren't many openings for a six-foot rodent, and we feel a bit sorry for him, so we've pulled a few strings and we've managed to get him a new job.
Smoke fags, rabbit, smoke fags!
Yeah, get that down there, mix-a-potato-spreading bastard. There you go.
Hello, I'm Lenny Henry. You probably remember me from programmes like Chef, Tiz Was, Three of a Kind, Lenny's Amazon Adventure, and Ainsley Harriet's Cookathon. If you, like me, have tuned in to watch South Park, don't worry. It'll be on right after the 11 o'clock show.
Oh, my God! They killed Lenny!
Here's a teaser. A special friend comes round to you for emotional support following a failed romance. Do you A, give them a shoulder to cry on, B, take them shopping, or C, strap a hidden microphone to your leg, then give the recording to the FBI? Well, that's from a quiz entitled How Much Are You Like Two-Faced Bitch Linda Tripp? Today, all 20 hours of Linda Tripp's secretly taped conversations with Monica Lewinsky about her affair with that president bloke were released to the world's media. But Tripp obviously wasn't used to having a secret microphone strapped to her thigh. Her inexperience shows at some crucial moments.
Monica, just tell me, did Bill Clinton ask you to lie?
Okay, I can trust you. He asked.
Linda, 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 huh? If only you held on to it for a couple of seconds longer. Now, the other problem is that Linda used ordinary tapes. You know what it's like, a good song comes on the radio, you just reach for the nearest cassette.
Gail tell you something really embarrassing about Bill? He's got this.
Now on WKNC in the Detroit.
It's no surprise to read then that the Republicans have brought in some audio experts to clean them up before release. This is the improved version.
Hey, man. Did the president actually behave improperly?
Yes, he did! And he's dead to our children, and he's a really awful president! Republican!
Well, to find out the impact the trip tapes have had in America, let's go live to our man in Washington, Rich Hall. Rich, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Fred. How are you, buddy?
I'm very well. It's nice to talk to you all the way across
the
big pond.
You're a great, good-looking Scotsman, kilt-wearing, haggis-eating freak you. How are you?
You've got me in a nutshell, Rich. Can you tell me, what's the gist of the transcripts in a nutshell?
All right, look, I got thousands of pages of them right here, okay? The most amazing thing about these transcripts, the mother knew the whole thing.
The mother knew
all along. Mrs. Lewinsky knows that Monica is having an affair with the president. Now, my question is, how do you tell your mom that you're having an affair with the president of the United States? You know?
Don't ask me.
You just sit down. Yeah. Maybe over the dinner table there, you're just, you know, Mom, these green beans are delicious. I'm blowing the president. You know? And then, what? And he's, oh, I said there's no time like the present. You know, look, this is my opinion, right?
Okay.
This is just my opinion, Fred. But I think that in the end, all these things, you know, all these people in history like Clinton, ultimately, it just comes down to one word, associations. You know, I mean, if you think about it, Lincoln, slavery, Roosevelt, Depression, Churchill, V-Day, Nixon, Watergate, Clinton, blowjob. Tony Blair, close personal friend of guy who got blowjob.
I understand perfectly.
Do you know that Congress, that's Congress right there.
Thank you.
Take a good look at it. That's Congress. That's where the Republicans are. Those are the guys who want to get Clinton out of office. Now, this morning, they asked President Clinton to give them $97 million to figure out a way to get rid of Saddam Hussein. I would give $97 million to Monica Lewinsky, give her a couple of cigars, and put her on the next plane to Baghdad. What is that, applause, or are you breaking up?
No, it's applause. Rich Hall in America, thank you very much. Former Home Secretary Michael Howard was back in the streets this morning after spending last night locked up in Brixton Prison as part of a charity event. Over 200 leading law figures joined him, including Master of the Rolls Lord Wolfe, who, according to The Telegraph, shared his cell complete with bunk bed, corner-flushing lavatory and hand basin with his wife, Marguerite. Mr. Howard is thought to have occupied a single cell. So he is a wanker, then.
You're watching the 11 o'clock show. And after the messages from the people who pay our wages, we'll be back with this.
Yeah.
All right. Easy enough. Nice. Yeah, man, that'll work. Yo, check this. I know it's been a bit whack until now, this show, but go roll yourself a spliff, because the second half is a lot better when you is mashed. I'm going to be talking to my main man, Judge Pickles, about the law and tin. Keep it real.
All about it, tough bloke in combat amidst the kissing men on the bottom. Thanks very much. Welcome back. Jack Straw unveiled new plans yesterday in the fight against organised crime. It says here in today's Times that Mr. Straw plans to give the courts the right to confiscate the assets of drugs barons even if they haven't been convicted of a crime. We sent our Channel 4 Voice of Youth, Ali G, to meet Judge Pickles and find out if these measures will affect the Staines Massive.
You don't stop. It goes out to the crew up top.
Yo, yo, what's up? I'm here checking out my main man, Judge Pickles. We're talking about the law. Now, law is something that you need to get down with if you don't want to go inside the nick. And it ain't boring, it don't need to let you stop you scoring. We're here to find out how it can be fun, but also know what's going on so you don't go down. Isn't that right, Judge Pickles?
I'm not sure it's fun.
Yeah, what is it then?
I did 40 years. I found it very boring on the whole.
Now, what is the Fifth Amendment? You getting me?
The Fifth Amendment Isn't that in America? That's an American thing, isn't it? It's not a British idea, is it? The Fifth Amendment.
When you say, I plead the Fifth Amendment...
Yeah, well, that's an American system. No, no.
Why not?
Well, because American law doesn't apply here.
Why not? What if it was a drink driving? If it was a drink driving charge, could you plead the Fifth Amendment?
You can never... In this country, the Fifth Amendment doesn't apply.
Never?
Not in court, no.
When can you murder someone?
When you say it, that's really a nonsensical question, if I may say so, because if you are entitled to kill somebody, it's not murder.
OK, but can you murder someone if someone, let's say, call your mum a slag? If they call your mum a slag, ring up the police. Police ain't going to do nothing, you know, they laugh at you.
Well, I don't know. It depends, I suppose. If you called my mother a slag and I then killed you, provocation can reduce murder to manslaughter.
So where's the line there? If they call her a slag, manslaughter. If they call her a bitch, that murder? OK, now you're a judge. How do you know when someone's guilty? Let's have this scenario. You've got a guy there, 19-year-old, driving around in top of the range Saab, all the lights and everything, leather seats, bitches in the front, bitches in the back, sitting on the woofer speakers, gold tooth, UV light underneath, big drum and bass coming out. The guy never done any work in his life. Is he a rapper or is he a dealer, considering he never touched any decks or held a mic ever in his life? Are you gonna put this man down?
Well, I'm not going to do anything except accept the verdict of the jury.
Yeah. What, you think this man ain't a dealer?
Well,
come on, you've got to put him down! Do you think women should be on juries?
Oh, yes, of course.
What about when they got the painters in? Oh. What about when it's rag week?
I'm sorry.
How can they be thinking straight? Serious?
Yeah. Well,
serious. My woman, she doesn't know what's going on. Guilty. Everyone is guilty when it's her time. Yeah. Everyone is guilty. I do something small. Guilty. You should be chopped. Whatever.
I don't honestly think you could start asking people intimate questions and saying, "Oh, you can't do it."
Exactly. That's why you should not have women on
the jury. No. I've never thought about this before, actually.
You get wise. Know what you're doing and get legal. Alright? Big shout going out. My main man, Pickles. Big shout going out.
Yesterday, the EU forced us all to work less with the introduction of the Maximum Working Hours Directive. What have they got cooked up for us today? Well, let's go over live to Brussels and catch up with our Euro correspondent, Wim van der Land. Wim, are you there?
Today, here in Brussels, the European Commission finally agreed its new broadcasting regulations. From now on, all news programmes will be replaced with episodes of Van der Valk. Episodes of The Waltons will be replaced with episodes of Van der Valk. And Prisoner Cell Block H will be dubbed over by Barry Foster, the famous actor who is most well known for playing the tubby Dutch dick Van der Valk.
Is that true, Wim?
No, of course not. It would just be stupid.
Then why are you doing this, Wim?
Because we're Europeans and we hate you British.
You know, it's bizarre. I've been talking to him all week and he's still under the impression I'm British. It's as if I'm talking to some sort of tape.
And now movies. We British might not have made any flicks as good as The Godfather, Schindler's List and Saving Private Ryan.
What about Mad Max 5? Everything grows back.
But we're top at turning out costume romps with pasty-faced girls in big dresses. The latest is called Elizabeth. It opened tonight and it turns the dull old history of Elizabeth I into a raunchy blockbuster. Here's a sneak preview.
In a time of treachery,
you are in the greatest danger.
Surrounded by enemies,
the time is close at hand.
She overcame impossible odds.
Do not be afraid of them.
To become England's most powerful queen.
Then let it all be done.
Do not fear to strike.
Elizabeth.
Now, the makers of the movie are so pleased with their popularist take on the monarchy that they've already started on a follow-up, which, like most sequels, won't be very good, and it'll be a bit of a rip-off.
In a time of post-Diana spin doctrine.
There was another floor here at that time.
Came a royal who suddenly found she had to hang with the homies, going football crazy.
I think Dwight York is so much better than Andy Cole, don't you?
And checking out the latest in street gear.
And this is size 6, Your Majesty.
Elizabeth II, get down with the crown.
The private life of a celebrity has been splashed all over the tabloids. Today's poor victim is top golfer Nick Faldo, who was split up with girlfriend Brenna Kepelak. The grubby son only got hold of the story when they were sent a fax by Nick Faldo.
An unfortunate Will Carling's been dragged through the mud this week after cheating on girlfriend Ali Cocaine. I wonder if she's got a cousin called Charlie. Anyway, Carling's personal affairs only became fodder for the gutter press when Will Carling decided to write a book about it.
So, if you happen to be married to a celebrity, don't bother talking to them about your feelings. Just read the papers every day.
Yeah. For example, I've gone right off my girlfriend Jenny. She's really boring. But I couldn't tell this morning. I didn't have the guts. But I did manage to get the story on CFAX. 11 o'clock show star Iain Lee has ditched lover Jenny because he wants to sleep with other women. Lee blasted, "I love sex and need to fulfill my lusty cravings. I need it 6 times a night." Now, she might not see that because she hasn't got CFAX, so I've also written a letter to her favourite magazine, Just 17. Well, it will be in a couple of years.
The most interesting thing to happen at the Labour Party conference this week was this, their colour-changing wall. Isn't this fantastic? Other than that, it was the most staged event since the actual documentary footage of the News Bunny earlier on. So we sent our roving reporter Dominic Jolly to stir it up a bit.
I'm here in Blackpool for the Labour Party conference. Now, New Labour epitomise everything about British politics. Squeaky clean and full of sound bites. This week, Tony Blair even tried to ban his own delegates from speaking in the conference.
Apart from the delegates, the other thing that embarrasses Tony Blair is his past life in a rock band, Ugly Rumours. I couldn't get a tape of them, so I recorded one myself. Ugly
Rumours. We've got Peter Hain MP here listening to Ugly Rumours. Seems to be tapping his feet. We've been given a tape of supposedly your husband in Ugly Rumours. Wondering if someone could, if you could confirm whether it is a real one or not.
It sounds quite interesting, doesn't it?
Do you like it?
I'm a great rock fan myself.
What do you think?
I'd say very, very prime ministerial.
In fact, Tony needn't have worried. Most of the delegates I met were skilled at giving short, snappy media sound bites.
And finally, if I could just ask you to describe this year's conference in a word.
Well managed.
That's two words. Okay. Can you just look and say exhilarating?
Exhilarating.
Interesting.
Abysmal.
Well, that was New Labour, and it beats me why Tony wants to keep that lot under wraps. Next week, we're in Bournemouth, and it's the Conservatives. Should be fun. See you there.
Everyone's belatedly apologising all of a sudden. Clinton apologised to the American people 9 months after lying about Monica Lewinsky. Yesterday, Police Chief Paul Condon apologised to the Lawrence family 5 years too late. But the Catholic Church scooped all records recently by apologising for the Crusades after a gap of 700 years.
So, here at the 11 o'clock show, we apologise before we've done anything wrong. Sorry about hitting you in the face, Fred.
That's okay, Brendon. Just time to remind you that we're all back tomorrow night with our compilation Best Of show, which we're calling possibly the best thrice-weekly written and performed hours from transmission satirical news / comedy show ever. Catchy.
Good night. Good night.